Call the Public Works meeting to order. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell's absent. Mr. Katura?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here. Okay, changes to the agenda. I see none. And we are going to, number eight will be pulled.
Okay.
And we have minutes. Can I have a motion to approve the minutes of April 2nd, 2014?
I will make a motion to approve the minutes of April 2nd, 2014.
And I'll second.
Sorry, I'm making sure. Okay.
What?
Couldn't hear her.
Roll call. Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes. And how about the minutes for April 7th, 2014?
Make a motion to approve the minutes for April 7th, 2014.
And I will second.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes. And we're going to hold the minutes of April 21st till the next meeting. Okay, pending, I see nothing. Under new, we have storm response status update, and I believe that is Mr. Dursick.
Good evening.
Good evening.
As usual, like we do every month, we hit all of our flood control sites again. We continued with our crews doing retention pond inspections for the homeowner associations and the individual lot owners. We did three HOAs and 33 individual lot owners, and that completes all the city-owned, homeowners-owned, and individual lot or homeowner association and individual lot owners. So our city crews have inspected them all. And with that being said, my secretary Marcy sent out letters to all these people with reminder letters to inspect and maintain their own retention ponds. And included in those letters were a copy of a new form so that they can fill them out themselves. And if there was a maintenance issue with retention pond, our inspection went with it so they know what they need to do any maintenance or cleaning in that retention pond. And we also include update sheets on contact information, because a lot of times the HOAs change presidents or new homeowners move in, so this way our contact information is updated. On another note, we filled 5 sinkholes throughout the city. Our sanitary crew responded to 9 sewer calls, all of them being private property issues, ranging from just debris in the lateral to roots. You know, PM sanitary sewer cleaning, they cleaned roughly 17,000 feet this past month on Glen Allen, Melbury Station. We completed the rest of the Oakview subdivision, Ashdown, Popham Place, Brackenberry, Winchester, Hambleton, Roundhead, part of Somme Center, part of Cromwell. And they will be working, finishing up Burrowood and continuing on in Liberty Hills. The storm vector cleaned basins on Mayapple and Cochran Road, and they did their PM catch basin cleaning on Crabtree, Lansdowne, Southwick, Stansbury, Ramblewood, Wintergreen, completed North Hill, and they're going to be working on Springside and Sharondale next. And they also jetted storm mains on Somme Center Road and jetted culvert pipes on Cannon Road. The TV crew completed dye testing on 13 sinkholes. 3 of those we have to put on a grouting contract for next year. 3 of them we have to do some manhole rehab. 5 of them there was no dye observed, and 3 we have to make 2 spot repairs. We continued our private property dye testing to follow from the smoke testing. We did 6370 Somme Center Road, dye test all the catch basins and the downspouts on the building. They all, even though they failed the smoke test, they passed the dye test. And the only repair they have to make is repair their test tee out front, because it's separated from the tee. In the PM lateral inspections, this is a list of private property owners that, since I've been here, we have some kind of a slight issue, and we go around and check them quarterly to make sure they don't back up. We had 5 come up this month, and 3 of those that we had to jet. And that's basically just to keep the preventative maintenance up between the tee and the main. Our basin crew repaired a sanitary manhole at the corner of Allenberry and Somme Center Road. And the program started this month, and they started their cutting of the roads on Rolling Brook Quarter Main and Fox Run. And just some future information, we will be doing our smoke testing this year in Somme Hills. And before we do the smoke testing, I will update the committee. We put letters out to all the residents, and we do put an advertisement in the paper so everybody's notified. And the smoke is non-toxic and not harmful if it does get in the house. Also, next month, I'll have an electro scan update and give the committee an update on how that went. And lastly, I'd like to point out a little issue that we have going on here. The document camera, please. Just to give everybody kind of a reference here, this is Somme Center Road. This is Pettibone. This is the Oakview subdivision. White Oak comes down here, right around the creek here where the blue line is. There's a creek, and back in 1983, there were gabion baskets installed, and the gabion baskets have failed. And I just have some photos here. This is standing on White Oak and looking upstream towards 91. You could see how the baskets were undercut and fell into the stream. And the last time that we were out there, John and I were out there, after the rain event, the water was so high, it was rolling over. The water level was on the top of the baskets here, and it was rolling over the top. And I just have a few other photos here of how it caved in. And I believe John is going to get a hold of Burgess and Leipold to make sure that we have engineer's drawing for this. Am I correct in saying that? And basically what we're looking for from the committee is a consensus on how do we want to approach doing the construction. Do we want to use our storm channel contract or storm sanitary contract to repair this, or do we want to contract it out, get a contract, and send it out for bid? The only thing is that I do see there is some sense of urgency with this, so my suggestion would be to use the storm contract. But if we do, if the committee does decide to send it out to bid, we need to move fast so we can get it out to bid.
I mean, I assume the problem's going to be is that it could cause flooding if this is all caved in and...
Correct.
We're going to have issues where that area could flood. Okay. Okay.
You wouldn't need a motion for that, would you?
No. You wouldn't need a motion. I believe the contract's already set for the... for the engineer's drawing, and we would just need to make sure the committee was on board with using the contractor.
Okay. The one item I would have to do with the engineering group would be to get some authorization or some fee proposal for that. Every project that we bring forward from them is an individual scope, so I'd have to bring something or get approval for something for them monetarily to perform that design. I mean, we have done other designs in other areas that would probably mimic this, so we could come up with some design of something in-house to do that if the committee would prefer.
Well, I mean, is that something that, I mean, I assume you probably have the old plans. Is it... Do you think you could do it in-house? I mean,
yeah, I do think we okay. could. As Bill mentioned, you know, there could be a sense of urgency to perform this work under the storm and sanitary contract.
Right.
We had a similar situation a year or two ago on Camp Industrial,
right,
where the committee had allowed us to perform that work under that contract in lieu of the bidding procedures.
Okay.
But we want to bring it forward to the committee and get their input as how they'd like us to move forward with this.
Okay. I mean, I would probably in ways, to me, it doesn't look like it's that complicated of a thing as far as having somebody else, Burgess and Niple, do the drawings. I mean, if you guys can do them in-house, am I wrong on that? Is this, it doesn't appear to be.
No, I'd be comfortable doing that design.
Okay. I mean, I don't want to see the area get flooded. I would be comfortable, I think, allowing you to go with our contractor that we have, you know, on for the storm situations.
I have a question with respect to if the longer we wait, what is taking place, I guess, further down the line? Is it impacting it in other ways?
Not so much downstream, it would be the impact upstream.
Okay.
Because not only is it across the creek now, you're going to have possible failure further up to that we're going to end up having to do more linear footage of gabion baskets because there's a potential that it could, because they're all connected together. So once one goes, they're all going to fall like dominoes.
Well, then it does seem like this is definitely falls under sort of an emergency.
I would say it's an emergency. I'm comfortable with you.
I am comfortable going forward as well.
Thank you.
And I have one other quick question.
Yes.
When you were talking in the beginning about, you know, going to the homeowners and the different, I mean, how's that been working out? Are they, you know, taking care of what they're supposed to be taking care of?
The maintenance is there. The issue that we have is the inspections are voluntary.
Okay.
And there is no language in the ordinance that says that they have to report to us if there's an issue. The only language is in there is for the maintenance of it.
Okay.
So that's why last year I started sending my own crews out there to make sure that they were maintaining them.
And
usually it's something, for the most part, yeah. On occasion, we have to send a letter. We've never had to take it to notice a violation yet.
Okay.
I'm sure everybody's cognizant of 2006, so.
Okay. Okay.
You know, like I said, the only issue we have is the inspection end of it.
Okay.
The maintenance end, we don't have any issues with.
Okay, thank you.
John's got some.
John.
Just one thing I'll add to that is Bill and I have talked about adding another section of the code to address that issue. So maybe when things slow down in the fall or this winter, we'll work on that language to
I think that might be a good idea. I mean, I know I had certain areas in my ward that, you know, and it went behind private property, so I'm curious whether, you know, and it's like you're going to kind of maintain and, you know, if the city's going to do the work, you're hoping that either homeowners or, you know, the residents will, in fact,
for
maintain it or take care of it.
For as long as we've had the contract, and I think Dan can agree with me, as long as we've went back in and rebuilt the basin back to its original construction drawings, okay, all of those homeowners or individual lot owners have done their due maintenance.
Oh, good, good, good. I knew the ones in my ward would, but no. Okay, great.
Thank you,
Bill. Okay. Okay, next item, City of Solon Infrastructure Improvement Report. I believe that's you, John.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Just update the committee on our infrastructure improvement report for the last month. We had, before I even get to the priority ones, we had some updates in our in the fourth line there, the approved change orders in 2004 for previously encumbered projects.
Mm-hmm.
So any projects that had money, had the monies or the project's dollars were encumbered in a previous year, and we had to come back to the committee for a change order for whatever reason. I have that line right there to document those funds. So we had some changes in that from updated that for the year up to $57,163.02. Moving into our priority one projects, I put the Linden base bid number in there when we finished this up for this packet. I wasn't sure about what alternates we were going to award, so that number will be further updated for next month, knowing that the committee and council had awarded the alternate one with that. So next month that number will be $1,463,525.50. Moving further down into the priority ones, we updated the award on the Hunter's Ridge project. Moving down to our recommended two priorities, the concrete repair program was awarded in the amount of $2,075,548. Moving down into our priority three projects, we had updates based on the construction inspection services being rolled over using our current vendor, GPD. We've had some approvals for design services through our general engineering services agreement to date in the amount of $247,367.46. And we had engineering chargebacks to date updated at $58,605.73. So if there's any questions that I could answer from the committee, I'll address those.
Yeah,
now.
I mean, these other projects, you know, the Brainerd Road, Bridal Trail, are those in process of you?
Yeah, as you're aware, the committee and council have awarded design services for the Bridal Trail and the Fox Run, the Bridal Trail being number two in the priority one and number seven in the priority ones. So those are currently under design.
Okay.
Brainerd Road, we just had a meeting with our, with that consultant Monday. They submitted their preliminary design for us. So I'm still, Bill's going to help me with some utility exploration in the next couple of weeks so we can verify some existing utilities out there prior to going to construction. We also submitted for our Army Corps permit for that project as well. So I fully intend to, that project for sure, and the rest of those would, those other two would be designed this year. We'll be also working, hopefully with BNN to help us continue our work on that preserve subdivision project. The Pepperwood drainage improvements is already under design. We are planning to have another residence meeting here very shortly. We're just finalizing our model and prior to having our follow-up residence meeting. So once we have the residence meeting, I think it'll be a short period of time before we'll be able to finalize those construction drawings and go to actual construction. Moving down into those priority two projects, our asphalt annual. I have a preliminary list of asphalt projects identified, just a matter of kind of going through that one more time with a fine-tooth comb and getting that finalized. Our preventative maintenance contract for crack sealing is out for advertising this week. And our catch basin and manhole repair, Dan and his guys are helping with the evaluation of a lot of those catch basins for the information we need to put the contract out for bid. Moving down to our priority threes, the sewer grouting, I'm planning to advertise that probably in the next week or so once I get the list from the service department. And the Salmon Aurora intersection right-of-way, there may not end up being any action on that yet this year, depending on our progress with our submittals through ODOT.
Okay. Any questions, Mark?
I do not have any questions.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, going on to item number three, the 2014 annual materials testing contract, the bid tabulation. And again, I'll get with you, John.
Yes, thank you. We had, on April 8th, we had one bid, and I apologize for the typo there, too. That should be 2014. We had one bid for GeoSci in the amount of $74,162.50. Our engineer's estimate was $80,000. And I've attached the bid table along with some other bid schedules that GeoSci has presented, or bid tabs of their work in the past. They've held this contract with us for several years in the past, being 2009, 2011, and 2013. I recognize that we don't typically like to see just one bidder on projects. So my plan is to talk to and invite some of the other plan holders or previous bidders to see what they might be able to provide us as input as to what's keeping them from bidding our project, whether it, I suspect that maybe some of our specifications are maybe a little too strict. So maybe we need to ease those back a little bit to entertain a few more bidders.
Right.
I am though recommending GeoSci's award, and I'm basing my recommendation on the fact that they've held our contract they've held our contract in previous years. They've also had a good working relationship with us, and I also did one other thing. I had provided the committee with a unit bid price comparison where I show their unit prices for the various items that we've bid and shown you the unit cost that they provided for us in 2011 and 13 and what they're proposing for 2014. And what you can see from the price comparison is that they've actually submitted the same unit cost of the work that was awarded in 2013. So based on that, I think that even though we got one bidder, it's a very good bid. We definitely need to get the contract awarded so that we can utilize the testing services. So based on the previous working relationship and the fact that the numbers are very good numbers, I'm recommending that we award this contract to GeoSci in the amount of $74,162.50.
I have a couple questions. I mean, just what is materials testing? What are you testing?
We use it predominantly for two projects. One is the concrete repair program.
That's right.
And the other one is the asphalt repair program.
Okay, so this is the test I kind of thought.
Yeah, do a lot of air slump and beam breaking and cylinder tests for a concrete repair, as well as testing at the plant for our concrete or for our asphalt projects.
So this testing makes sure that we're getting the right materials.
We're getting what we specified. We're getting a good quality product, and that there's no issues with the material when it comes and is installed at the site.
And I mean, the second thing, I really don't like when we only have one bid.
I don't either.
In the past, I mean, last year looks like we had three companies bid.
Right.
Are those other three, are they not in business? Are they still in business?
No, they're still in business.
Okay.
That's why, as I noted in the memo, I intend to sit down with a lot of these previous plan holders and previous bidders to see what we could propose to change in our specifications that would make them, you know, interested in bidding again. And as I had mentioned, I think a lot of it might be with the specifications that we have for some of the requirements around the, not the actual test, but the testers and the certifications that we have or require them to hold as part of the contract. I think if we kind of loosen that up or lighten those requirements a little bit, I think we'd probably get a few more bidders.
Okay. Anything, Mark?
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify something. They would be testing the materials for all of the projects, like even including like the Hunter's Ridge.
Yes.
Not just things that are specifically.
Yeah, those are some of the major things that we use them for, but for projects like Hunter's Ridge and Linden, we would use GeoSci to also come and test the compaction of the trenches for the sewers that are being installed when the contractor's out compacting the granular backfill or the existing soil back in the trenches. We'd have GeoSci on site to come out and test those compaction tests to make sure that the backfill is getting compacted in the trenches properly. A project like Hunter's Ridge, we'd have them also doing the testing of the concrete, just like they would for the concrete repair program. So these testing services are important, are an important part of our construction process.
And I would assume if we were to say to throw out this bid and reopen, the time frame would be, you know, to see if we could get more bidders.
It would probably be another month before we would have this rejected and re-advertised and back to the committee.
Okay. And by then, these road projects would be going on, and there'd be nobody to really check.
Unfortunately, yes.
Okay. Like I said, go ahead, Mark.
You know, obviously, I don't like only having one bid either.
No, and neither do I. And I think one of the things that came out of that bid comparison for me was the fact that the numbers were the same as last year.
Right, I can see that.
And I know that we had they performed that contract very well for us last year, and that was one of the main factors of why I was recommending them, was because their costs were the same as last year. I think if they had been higher than last year, I definitely wouldn't have made that recommendation because I think we probably should have gone. I would probably have recommended that we maybe extend their current contract until we would be able to competitively rebid this new one.
You okay with it?
No, I am okay with it. Like I said, I'm not comfortable with just one bid, but it's kind of the gross limiting factor to kind of getting the shovels in the ground on a lot of projects, or we get the shovels in the ground, but then take a serious risk of not, you know, of having to then go and redo things because of bad materials. So I think we're in a position where they've done the project in the past, and you've been pleased with their work. And then the second thing is that there was not a price increase from the year before. So I think taking those things into consideration, I am comfortable to make the motion.
Okay, I can make it.
Or you can make the motion.
I'll make the motion. Okay, I'll make a motion to have a legislation prepared to accept the bid of GeoSci Incorporated for the 2014 annual materials testing program in the amount of $74,162.50.
Second.
Roll call. Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes. Okay, thanks, John.
Thank you.
Okay, item number four, citywide traffic signal improvement contract, change order number five. Looks like you, John.
Yes. I have a change order request here before the committee for our citywide traffic signal improvement project. It is actually for an ultimate decrease of the contract by $6.10. It comprises of 10 individual items, which I had individually explained in my memo. The first one being for signal pole revisions. And what I mean by that is there's been some changes with the project, and predominantly with the SOM and Aurora intersection, where we've had meetings with ODOT, and they're allowing us to take all of the work items associated with that intersection and move that work and those dollars forward to our upcoming project. So there was a lot of poles that are associated with that intersection that we didn't perform, as well as there's a few on Solon Road and Cruzy Drive intersection that we're going to non-perform. So there was a cost credit associated with that item of $101,702. The second item is associated with number one, in the fact that at Solon and Cruzy, we are going to, I'm proposing that we would use the existing signal poles that we're going to be removing from the Bainbridge and Cruzy Drive intersection. Those are existing ornamental poles. Mm-hmm. So I have a proposal here of $5,977.73 to refurbish those existing poles and then have them installed at the new intersection. We've worked it out with the designer and had it reviewed also by our traffic engineering consultant to verify that we could reuse some of those poles. So that cost is to have those poles refurbished. And by that, I mean all of the old paint will be removed and repainted, and then they'll be reinstalled and repurposed at the Solon and Cruzy intersection. Moving on to number three, we have a need we had some contaminated soil issues at Salmon Aurora, which we needed to deal with as soon as that was uncovered. There was a high odor of gas associated with that, and that cost was $4,266.75. So we're requesting that as part of this change order. Number four, this is a cost to have a pull box removed at a unit cost of $412.92 per pull box. We're requesting 15 of those, and we've had 8 of those to date. Moving on to number five, we are proposing to add $113,457.50 of additional handicap ramps and associated sidewalk. ODOT has agreed to assist with this funding to upgrade some of the existing handicap ramps that are in place now that, because the requirements of the ADA have changed, that may have made the what might visually appear to be a compliant ADA ramp is actually not compliant. So that's some additional work there. We'll be actually paying about 20% of that city work. So 80% of those costs will be picked up by ODOT. Number six, the contractor had a value engineering proposal to use
a different mounting bracket for signs. That would be a credit to the city of the cost of $51,365. Moving on to number seven, another value engineering proposal with a net credit of $4,270 to use PVC conduit risers instead of galvanized. And those are the pipes that you see on the side of the utility poles where wires would come from underground and go up the side of a pole to the aerial mounting. Moving on to number eight, this winter when the contractor was installing concrete foundations, we had a few obstructions that we had come across during the drilling process. Those were both on Somme Center. One was near the Sears intersection, and one was at the Bainbridge intersection. So that work was completed for a price of $1,950.32 during the process of drilling the foundations. Moving on to number nine, this is a request for $7,000 to pay the contractor to assist us with on a time and material basis to uncover our existing conduit in various locations where we're finding we may have an obstruction, whether that's just dirt and debris, which the service department's been helping us a lot with jetting some of those out. But there also are other areas where we may have had some unknown damage to our conduit system. May have not have actually damaged the wire inside, but it's damaged the conduit, and we're not able to pull new wire through that. Okay. That's number nine. And then number 10, this is to install brackets on utility poles so that we can mount our fiber optic cable throughout the city to connect all of our signals back here to City Hall. We're proposing the potential need of 56 arms at $330.08. This is an idea that we came up with as a potential way to eliminate make-ready costs through the illuminating company and AT&T. You have to maintain certain spaces of the wires on the pole, and if we can use this bracket to hang out over the side of the pole versus on the pole, in some cases it actually makes the distances correct, so we can reduce the make-ready cost.
Okay.
Which ultimately makes the contractor's time go quicker, and we get our project done quicker. So those 10 items with the pluses and minuses come up to a decrease of the contract value of $6.10. So if the committee, I'm recommending this change order to the committee, and like I said, it would decrease the current contract value of $4,601,328.87 to $4,601,322.77. And as I noted in my memo, the backup for the 10 items is in our office. I actually brought it here so you could see it. It was this thick, so that's why I didn't copy it into the packets.
Thank you.
But it is available if you'd like to review it.
I have one question. Item number two.
Yes.
I thought that was a traffic signal. Oh, wait, Solon Road. Okay. And the removal of the Bainbridge Road. Which one was the developer? I mean, originally, I think they were going to remove when they went around town and figured out which traffic signals really weren't needed. And then, am I thinking, is it Bainbridge Cruzy?
Yeah, it's the intersection at Bainbridge and Cruzy Drive,
right,
is one of the unwarranted signals,
right,
that the committee and council agreed that we would remove.
Okay.
So those are the ornamental poles that we're going to be removing, and then I'm proposing here to refurbish those, and we're going to be reusing those at the Solon and Cruzy Drive intersection.
Okay, because my understanding was that the developer wanted to keep the light,
and then
he was going to pay for it.
And then the intersection
thinking?
At Cruzy and Uptown Solon,
okay,
is the one that the developer DDR proposed to keep, and we have an agreement with them to get reimbursed for that cost.
I recall that, and I just wanted to...
Yeah.
Okay, you have any questions, Mark?
No.
Okay, do you want to...
Sure, I'll try.
Make a motion to prepare legislation to approve change order number five, a reduction of $6.10 for the citywide traffic signal improvement project contract number 2010.20, and reference John Bush's memo to the Public Works Committee dated April 30th, 2014.
Second, roll call, please.
Mr. Katara?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, item number five, the 2013 annual asphalt repair contract change order number three. Now, it looks like we have Dan Driscoll. Hi, Dan.
Yes, hello, Mr. Chairman. Last year, our Karen Asphalt began our 2013 annual asphalt repair program for us. They got it approximately halfway finished, and we had granted them a time extension to have it complete by the end of this month. Because of the cold, wet weather, the plants hadn't been opened, and work really wasn't possible until this past week or two. And they have started their work in the Windy Hill area and been working at it diligently ever since, but they will require a little bit more time to get it completed. They're asking for an additional month until June 30th, and I think that's a reasonable request. One of the things that will also help them with is, in particular in the Baldwin area, they'll be able to do that work on that street after the school's out, and then it won't be a problem for all of the traffic over there. So I'm requesting that they would be granted a 1 month time extension until June 30th.
Okay. One quick, how many streets that weren't done in 2013? I know I have one in my ward. But.
Probably about eight of them, and I can probably go down the list here and review those with you. Like I said, they're working on the alternate streets at Suzanne, Windy Hill, Laura Lane. They got Delmar Court, Teasel Court to complete. Let's see what else we've got here. Some patching in the Thornberry subdivision, patching on Aurora Road, patching on Somm Center on the north end. Meadow Lane, there's a couple of patches that need to be done over there. Hidden Creek Circle is probably the next location that they'll be moving their equipment to. We've got Baldwin and Everton. And I think that's everything that needs to be completed by June 30th, or right now, May 31st.
Okay, are you okay with Mark?
No, I'm fine.
Okay. Okay, I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared to approve change order number three to extend the completion date of the 2013 annual asphalt repair program from May 31st, 2014 to June 30th, 2014.
Second.
Okay. Thank you.
Roll call.
Mr. Couture?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes. Okay, item number six, the 2013 annual sewer grouting contract change order number two. Looks like we have you again, Dan.
Similar to the asphalt program, the grouting contractor was also given a time extension, a 90-day time extension. His work was to be completed in January, and he honestly had all of the mainline work done in January and held off on the sewer lateral work for the spring, and it requires a little bit of a different process. Again, cold, wet weather caused him to not get out there until just a couple weeks ago. And since he's been out there, he's honestly running into a couple of glitches. A lot of this underground sewer work is in developmental stages, to say the least. There's one contractor that makes the, or one manufacturer that I'm aware of that makes the equipment that can do the grouting of the laterals above ground without any excavation. They're having a little bit of trouble with that, but they're working really hard at trying to get it accomplished. I felt that it was fair to grant them a 45-day time extension to work the bugs out of their process and hopefully get that work accomplished. And I'm asking that you would approve that.
I don't have any problems with that.
Yeah, I think it's a reasonable request, and I'm comfortable making the motion to prepare legislation to approve change order number two to the 2013 annual sewer grouting contract 2013.11, the purpose of which is to extend the completion date from May 1st, 2014 to June 15th, 2014.
Second, roll call, please.
Mr. Couture?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes. Okay, item number seven, authorization to auction surplus vehicles and equipment on GovDeals. I believe that is You, Mr. Bandiera.
This is just some various pieces of equipment and vehicles that we've accumulated in the service department. Some have already been replaced, some will not be replaced, but we're asking authorization to get rid of that list, 1 through 11. I can go through it specifically if you would like me to, but again, some of the items are, have already been replaced, like the tire mounting and balancing machine. We had authorization to put that on our annual appropriations. It went through the budget hearings. We replaced that, and then some of the vehicles there need extensive repairs. There's no sense in keeping them in the fleet, and it states in the memo where which ones were already replaced. But it would be my recommendation to remove that list of equipment above from the city's assets by means of gov deals.
Okay. Any questions, Mark?
No.
Okay, I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared to authorize the auction of surplus vehicles and equipment through gov deals, as noted in the memo from Tom Bandiera to the Public Works Committee dated April 29th, 2014.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes. Okay, and we tabled item number 8, so we're going to go to item number 9, which is surcharge review. Mr. Salonis, how are you?
Good evening. Good, how are you doing?
Fine, thank you.
I actually have some good news for change. And what we did is we completed our surcharge rate review. We have to do that once a year as part of our agreement with the city, part of our ordinance. What we do is we take comparable costs of what our expenditures were for 2013 and compare them to actual loadings that we actually treat. And these are the surchargeable loadings, which is BOD, suspended solids, oil and grease, total phosphorus, and ammonia. And this is what we surcharge industry for. There's about 8 industries in the city that are affected by these rates. And what we calculated out once we did our methodology, we have a whole methodology that, and I wanted to introduce Stan Smith. I don't know if the committee has met Stan Smith.
Hi.
Stan Smith is our monitoring division manager. He actually administers the industrial pretreatment program and does a surcharge rate review and the charges.
Okay.
So he does a good job. And if you have any specific questions, I will probably refer those to Stan. Okay. But for BOD, the actual rates calculated out to be equal. Suspended solids that went down from 0.295 to 0.250. Oil and grease went down from 0.376 to 0.317 cents. Total phosphorus went from 1.339 to 1.962. Ammonia went from 1.972 to 1.390. Overall, what this is going to mean, since all the industries are affected differently by what they actually give us, they're not going to all see the same amounts that they would see as a savings. But the best I could say is we're going to see approximately about a 7.2% savings for the industrial as a whole, the industrial users as a whole, and that's about $66,000 a year. So what we would like to do, since this is in ordinance form, we need to adjust the rates and actually get the ordinance changed as well. Last year when I did this calculation, we actually showed that we were had maintained our costs. Our costs were held down. And we showed that, we could actually cut back rates at that time. And I think we had the discussion during the committee, but I was hesitant. I don't like to do it, as soon as I see it. I try to keep the rates stable as much as I can. We actually have in our calculation to try to make sure that we're stabilizing the rates as much as we can when we do those calculations. And it's come out for a couple years now that we're showing that we should decrease the rates. So it's our recommendation that we do that at this time. And when we sit down and look at those also, we try to project what the next year is going to be, what our expenditures for 2014 on out. And we, foresee that those are going to be relatively stable and that we can adjust these rates accordingly.
Okay, and then just the TP one, I'm just reviewing this again for the total phosphorus.
Total phosphorus, right.
Okay, now that obviously jumps, but what I'm reading here is that it it shouldn't cause a big increase, that not, you don't get that.
No, and I could probably defer that to Stan to let him, there's not a whole lot of industries that are affected by the phosphorus.
Okay. And the reason for, is just because of the ferric chloride going up that you had to increase the?
Yes.
Recommended rate?
The currently, there's only one industry in the last year that had any surcharge for phosphorus. It was a fairly modest amount of a few hundred dollars. So it does not have a significant impact on industry as a whole.
Okay.
The cost for phosphorus has gone up because the ferric chloride bid last year was significantly higher than previous bids because of the change in the market. And then also, the chemical precipitation of the phosphorus creates additional sludge loading, so it, we allocated additional sludge loading costs to that charge as well.
Okay. Any questions, Mark?
I don't know if they have any questions per se. I guess, kind of excited by the fact that we're able to do this. And I think it just sort of adds to the what makes it a privilege to do business in the city of Solon. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah,
I do want to commend you, Director Solonix, for all your efforts and trying to get the plant operating as efficiently as possible.
Thank you. And I want to recognize, you know, the staff. I mean, Stan, Clint Krendick, and the whole staff that we have down there. Everyone's done awesome job to, you know, we've cut our staff from, we were at 28 people at one time, we're down to 17. You know, we've done a lot of cost-cutting measures down at the plant to try to reduce chemical usage, try to reduce our utility usage. Some of the improvements we've done over the years, we added automated aeration system that's helped us reduce our electrical costs. We contracted out sludge hauling, that's, you know, reduced manpower. You know, actually all the costs attributed with the trucks and everything else that was involved with that significantly reduced our expenditures. So, you know, thanks to them and thanks to the staff, we've been able to maintain our costs and keep them where we can maintain our rates. I think, as I mentioned before, you know, we're actually envisioning not having to increase our sewer rates for the next few years. So I think in this day and age that you can actually hear those statements come out of somebody that's a utility, that they're not raising mm-hmm. rates, that we're actually able to reduce what we're surcharging. It's good news.
Thing. Yeah, I'm glad, and I like that you brought up, you know, I mean, obviously the residents, that's a, you know, an issue is, you know, not to have, you know, an increase in the sewer billing.
Correct.
You know, which I think I'm sure everyone appreciates, because as you just said, everybody else is looking to increase the rates. So, you know, good work. Echo Mark with that, and keep up the good work.
It's a big benefit also to, you know, that we're not part of, you know, a bigger conglomerate like the sewer district. I mean, by us maintaining our own plant, we can control those costs, and working with the administration, we're able to, you know, work closely with council, with the mayor, and make the best decisions for the plant.
Okay.
Operating a business in Cleveland, I can tell you, I would be pleased to get a notice from the sewer district saying that they were actually going to decrease rates rather than increase them. So again, I'm always proud of Solon, and so I'm definitely proud that we're able to buck that trend of increasing costs and passing it on to the residents and businesses. So. You want me to try to make this motion? I'd like to make a motion to implement the sewer rate adjustments that were referenced in Director Solonix's April 29th memo to the Public Works Committee, and to make necessary changes to Ordinance 1046.04C to reflect those changes.
Second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Paul. Okay, correspondence, I see none. Other, I see none. Projects and reports. Engineering Department Study Design Report. I believe that's probably you, John.
It is. I went through an extensive update of our active projects under item number two. If there's any other questions the committee might have, I could entertain those now.
Okay. I don't have any again.
Okay. Oh, on number three, I guess I was just curious. There was a follow-up meeting scheduled for May 2nd.
That was with our consultant that we've been having. Like, as I had mentioned previously, we've had several meetings with our consultant regarding the stormwater model and the sizing of the detention basin for the Timber Lane property. So we're hopeful that we're very near the end of that process, and we plan to be having a follow-up residence meeting with the residents on Timber Lane once we have that information completed.
Okay, so we're still in that process of dotting the I's and crossing the T's.
Yes.
So to speak. Okay.
But I do think we're at the almost at the finish line of that process.
It's been a quest.
I mean, I just have one, you know, looking at the annual contracts, the concrete repair contract, and I don't know, Dan, if you want to answer this, a number of roads that were done last year that, you know, maybe kind of aren't in great shape after the winter, does the contractor then go back out and probably specifically speaking of Richmond Road?
Speaking specifically of asphalt streets, probably okay. Took the worser hit of the two okay. types of roads we have. The concrete roads, I don't believe that we've
okay.
noticed any real major
okay.
problems.
You're okay with that.
You know,
okay.
the aprons went up over the winter, and as far as I'm aware, most of those are okay. settling back into the places
okay.
where they need to be. Richmond Road had a few minor repairs that needed to be done, in particular at the water valves, and the contractor, we showed those to him a couple of weeks ago, and
mm-hmm.
he's already gone out there and made
okay.
repairs to those.
Okay.
Liberty Road is another location where he's going to do some repair work, and again, and with regard to the time extension and because of the type of material that is, I'm kind of considering that to be punch list work on Liberty Road, mm-hmm. but he's going to do some fairly extensive repair work, and we'd really like to do that in the June or July
yeah.
range
okay.
when the temperatures
okay.
are warm enough to get that okay. done. But yeah, we are following up with those.
Okay.
And
I just want, you know, residents and people to, you know that you do follow up and make sure that, you know, the repairs were done correctly. Okay. All right. Okay. You okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Item number 11, sidewalk program update. Leave that to you, Dan.
Again, I started putting the sidewalk in again this month into the report. We weren't doing any over the winter. We have the new program, and once again, just like last year, our sidewalk repair program is going to be a part of the overall concrete repair program. We've got 20,000 square feet. We have a small list that's included in the contract book and some other lists that of things that have been reported to us. That I expect that by next month we'll have some sidewalk repairs that'll be reported on this list. The program's only started about 2 weeks ago, and they
okay.
started on Hall
okay.
Street, and there really aren't any sidewalks
mm-hmm.
yet.
And just a question on that: if a resident, you know, has a really uneven sidewalk, do they call you, or I mean, do they call the engineering department or service
yeah.
or?
Any sidewalks that aren't in the driveway area. We don't repair the drive aprons.
Right.
We don't repair the sidewalks that are in the driveway area. But if there's the 4-inch sidewalks on any of the main streets, they could call us and report us, whether they're in front of our house or whether they're
okay.
in front of someone else's house. Give us the address.
Right.
We'll go out there and take a look at it and compare it to the criteria that's basically in the city engineer's ordinance with
mm-hmm.
regard to surface deterioration, offset joints, reverse slope. So it has puddling, multiple cracks, things like that would be a cause for replacing sidewalks.
Okay, thank you. Any questions?
John.
In addition to that, there is a form right on the front page of the website, a quick link where residents can
okay.
Click that and make the report right online through the city's website,
oh,
and that'll come right into our office.
Okay, great. Okay, thank you. Okay, item number 12, the 2014 Annual Emergency Road Repair Program Update. Dan?
Similarly, we're starting up a new year with our annual emergency road repair contract. We really haven't called them out to do any work yet, but we do have a small list of basically asphalt repairs that we've been aware of since last fall or over the winter, that during the course of the next couple of weeks, we're going to have the contractor come out and make those repairs, and along with some grass restoration from work that was done over the winter.
Great. Okay. Any questions?
No.
Okay. Item number 13, the 2013, sanitary and storm system repair program update. Bill Dursick.
Yeah, there's no updates with that one, but I do want to notify the committee that the 2014 contract started this week. So next month, you could expect a memo with regards to that.
Okay. Very good. Okay. Item 14, the Water Reclamation Department report. Oh, I'm sorry, John.
I would propose to the committee that now that we'll be on the 2014 program that
now that we're on the,
that we're on the 2014 program that we wouldn't be reporting on that 2013.
Okay.
Yep. Thank you.
So that'll just roll over the 33,000 that's left.
No.
No, the 33, they'll probably liquidate.
Let's just look, okay.
Right.
Okay.
They then prepare closeout documents and finish the contract out, and then we start fresh with 2014.
Okay. Okay. Item 14, Water Reclamation Department report. Paul?
I don't have anything new for the report, but just a FYI to bring the committee up to date. I was hoping to have the new CDM proposal for the wet weather for the continuance of the wet weather overflow program, their assistance in the engineering services for the upcoming year. But I did not have that ready in time, but I hope to bring that to the next meeting. It was a significant reduction from the cost from last year, and more or less just from the point that there's going to be a little less work that we're going to need from them, which we anticipate as we start narrowing down our focus. Secondly, I am working on our request for proposals, the descriptions to get that out. So hopefully I will have that out in the next couple of weeks for the preliminary improvement study that we're going to be doing on our headworks.
Right. Okay. Okay. Any questions, Mark?
No.
Okay. Item number 15, a service department report. Tom?
Can I answer any questions anybody have about the report?
Yeah, I think the only thing that, you know, kind of jumped out, and obviously you had no control over this, but is the overtime. You know, you're already, I mean, are you going to be okay with that? I
really couldn't say at this time. I mean, it was a very, very bad winter. You know, there are weekend sewer calls. There are other things that the service department responds to, even on a weekly basis, after hours, after midnight, weekends. But you know, it was a bad winter. We responded to many snow and ice events. We'll monitor it as we go along, but I can't guarantee that we wouldn't have to come back at some point.
Okay. No, understandable. But
I would like to make a couple a note about what we're doing with the road patching right now and where we're working at. We're working in the Longview area. We had to do some work on some of the industrial areas that were just, you know, in bad shape after winter. We are prioritizing the worst areas first, working our way from north to south. But if there's a particular hole that somebody sees, we have the garbage, the solid waste guys. If they see something, you know, they'll call it into dispatch, notify the manager. But we don't always see, you know, every single hole. But if someone sees something that looks like it needs to be patched, called into the service department, we'll check it out. We'll put it on a list to get it filled as quickly as possible. But we're trying to make a little more permanent repair right now with a hot patch material versus, you know, we switched over from the cold patch. And, you know, that should hold up pretty well.
Good. Okay.
So.
No, I don't.
Okay. And inactive, we have a contract follow-up. I guess that's still inactive. So. Okay. Any other? Everybody okay? Okay, Dan?
I was just going to state that with the regard to the contract follow-up, I think I sent you about 8 or 10 of the contractor evaluation forms over the past month. I'll probably send a few more, half a dozen more in the upcoming weeks so you can see the evaluations that were given to the contractors that are working on their streets. If you have any response to that, anything you'd like to tell me, just get in touch with me.
I thought they were informative. I kind of enjoyed, you know, going through I think they were helpful.
All right, well, good.
So thank you for that. Okay, anything else? Okay, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make the motion.
Okay, I'll second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.